themselves with others' work, market their talent and skill, advertise the things that they make, maintain relationships with other creators, and all the other benefits that come with being able to directly cultivate and interact with an online social following. However, for this very same reason, these communities tend to orient feedback and sharing around impressive final products, making them ideal for maybe experienced creators who are maybe already familiar with how to improve their work. And so in other words, what you get on these communities is a very limited view of what others are doing, and interactions made up mostly of admiration and generic encouragement. And these types of comments can be great, but this also seems like a huge lost opportunity in that we have the means to gather so many people together online, but with the majority of these interactions being pretty superficial. So instead, how can we design social systems to encourage deeper interactions between creators? To answer this question, some of my work looks at how social systems can take the creative process into account. So that is, what if communities and tools took into account the fact that creative work involves not just final products, but a whole process of refining and evolving and flipping around ideas and techniques. And the creative process includes all sorts of useful information, like and experiences like creators' intent and goals, the techniques that they use, what fails and what succeeds, and how people go about solving problems. And if we can expose this in the design of creativity support tools, we might be able to provide opportunities for giving feedback, sharing techniques paired with examples, or promoting mindsets where struggle is normal, maybe even celebrate it, rather than kind of hidden behind this like grand final product. So in this talk, I'll talk about three research questions I've been exploring through a couple of projects. First, I'll talk about Mosaic, where I looked at how to design online creative communities so that they focus not just on showing off final successes, but on helping creators support each other while they work. Second, in Motif, I explore how we can extract techniques used by expert videographers and make them accessible to novice creators for use in their own video stories. And lastly, I'll talk about Mechanical Novel, where I looked at how to get the crowd to engage in practices of reflection and revision to collaboratively write short fiction stories. So first, Mosaic. So this project came out of the observation that, kind of just like how I described, when you work on something, the final product is obviously a major creative outcome, but so are things like failure and struggle, unexpected setbacks, new inspirations, and maybe there are some advantages to incorporating these other kinds of outcomes in social systems. But currently, creators face a lot of barriers when trying to share these other kinds of outcomes in current communities. So, for example, imagine wanting to post a preliminary sketch on a popular online community so that you can get feedback. So, on a website like DeviantArt, it's pretty likely that a post like this would be passed over in favor of more impressive work. And even if people do find your post, it's not clear that you'd want to, considering the kind of comments that you might get. So unlike maybe a studio environment where you might come to trust and get to know the people that you work around who are probably also creators, here you might get comments from others without knowing who these people are or where they even come from. And even if you got good feedback, it's not clear what you should do after that. Would you like replace the old image with the new one after showing your new progress, or would you make a new post? The affordances for this aren't super clear. So instead, what if rather designing online creative communities like galleries, we design them to be a little bit more like studios? So that is, what if creative communities were designed from the get-go to allow creators to share creative process as first-class content? So rather than just sharing finished work, creators could share in-progress snapshots of work to illustrate what they did and why. And in a social environment that rewards sharing early work and puts creators rather than viewers in the center of interactions online, creators might be able to not only learn specific techniques from each other, but also reflect more effectively on their own work and on others' work. So first, to get a sense of how a community like this might compare against existing art communities, we first interviewed 10 artists about the art communities that they already use to share their work. We recruited these people from existing art communities on Facebook, Tumblr, and DeviantArt. And overall, interviewees said that they do mainly use existing social media sites to share their artwork for the purpose of getting as much exposure as they can. And while many of them have posted works in progress on these sites in the past, it was mostly to serve a social purpose, basically a kind of, hey, here's what I'm up to kind of thing, rather than to teach or reflect. And when we asked about how they use existing communities for resources or inspiration, nearly all the participants mentioned that finding an amazing piece of artwork fueled their motivation to work on art, but this was also paired with a struggle to reverse engineer how an inspiring piece was even made, since that information wasn't available most of the time. So overall, despite the popularity of creative communities online, and despite a desire to share and get feedback on their process, many creators found that the social and technical affordances of existing communities didn't accommodate the stuff they wanted to get out of like actually being in a community of creators. So with these barriers that these artists mentioned in our preliminary interviews in mind, we designed and launched Mosaic, an online social art platform where the primary method of sharing artwork is to upload multiple images illustrating the creative process, the steps that an artist took to create a piece of artwork. So to illustrate this, say we have a Mosaic user who's just starting on a watercolor portrait, and at this stage, maybe they've done a few sketches exploring their idea. And now that they've made some progress on their work, they might go to Mosaic to create a project, which represents a single creative work. And then they would add works in progress, representing steps in the progress that they've made so far, along with a description of any reasoning behind their steps, such as why they chose a certain type of subject matter, or how they chose a certain visual composition. And maybe at this point, the artist is done with their work for today, and maybe plan on working on it a little more later. And during this time, other Mosaic users can come and can see projects that others have posted and make comments. So here, a user steps in and says, hey, looks great so far. By the way, the anatomy is actually off in your sketch. And what this commenter is pointing out here, if you want a little bit of a tip on drawing people, is that the raised arm is actually not in a realistic spot. So the hips and the shoulders and the human body tend to angle oppositely from each other. So that part is okay, but the side with the raised arm should probably be on the higher shoulder, which is currently conflicting with the way that the hips and shoulders are aligned. And so taking that feedback, the artist can make adjustments, which in this case is to switch the raised arm so that's on the higher shoulder. And so over time, as the creator continues working on their project, they can add more snapshots and document their thoughts along the way. There are other social features on Mosaic that enable artists to view what others are doing. The homepage consists of a feed of recent activity and shows comments, new projects, and new updates to existing projects.
Does this page provide drawing quick capabilities, or do you do it on your own?
Yes, it's like tool agnostic. So you would use whatever tools that you currently have, and then upload images to this community. So there's the homepage where you can see what other people are doing. You can also search for projects by keyword or even by specific type of work in progress. So you can search for other people's sketches to see how they did a particular step. And so in this way, by centering users' interactions around sharing process, Mosaic might be able to unlock a number of useful interactions between creators, including being able to compare your own creative process with others, learn new techniques, and provide specific feedback. So our hypothesis with Mosaic here was that sharing creative processes is difficult for creators because existing creative communities are designed to reward sharing high-quality creative outcomes. So to understand the difficulties that artists face when seeking or sharing works in progress online, we conducted a field deployment of Mosaic over the course of 4 weeks. We invited users from hobbyist art communities to use Mosaic to host snapshots of works in progresses of whatever they happen to be working on. And during the study period, we logged and coded all community activity, including the creation of projects, works in progress snapshots, comments, etc. And finally, at the end of the study period, we conducted semi-structured interviews with 10 of the most active Mosaic users to understand whether posting works in progress affected their creative practice and how they interacted with other Mosaic users. And by the end of the study period, a total of 46 users created 69 projects, with projects containing an average of about 5 works in progress each, and an average of about 2 comments. And there was an interesting range in the types of images that people would upload. So while many people uploaded a typical step-by-step set of images, like in this example, others posted more contextual things, like photos of their work environment and their tools, or included initial exploratory sketches that weren't ultimately used in the final product. And speaking with interview participants, we did find a few themes in how creators approach sharing their work on Mosaic. So first, participants described posting about their process as a useful way for them to reflect on their work. A few artists pointed out that documenting their process on Mosaic would be useful for their future selves, to kind of help them remember that a lot of really great past projects started kind of awkward and terrible, and so they shouldn't feel bad about a horrible start to a new project. And this tendency to reflect showed through in the captions that users wrote as well. So rather than describing exactly kind of the step-by-step of what they did, creators wrote a lot about kind of internal thoughts. Like in this example, where they wrote about why they chose to draw what they did. So in other words, mosaic projects ended up almost more like diaries rather than what you would think of as traditional tutorials. Secondly, feedback was helpful for reflection as well. So creators mentioned that they used comments from others as sort of a mirror to help them figure out whether or not they were able to achieve their goals. And this is something that they try to do on other platforms as well, but on Mosaic, the fact that people could see the process behind how something was made seemed to lead to comments that were more that were perceived as more informed by what the artist was actually trying to do. And third, posting art in terms of process also implicitly enforced a community norm of reciprocal effort. So enforcing this fairness can be quite difficult on existing sites like DeviantArt, where commenting on someone's artwork doesn't give them a reason to give you a helpful comment back. But on Mosaic, participants mentioned that being able to see someone working on something made for more of a payoff for following or commenting on someone's work as they were working on it.
It might be interesting if you added a morphing function to your page so that people could see the work evolved in a morphing way.
Oh yeah, that would be really interesting to kind of like tie it more closely together.
Yeah. You might just, you know, see what the influences were at the time.
Okay, yeah, that's definitely an interesting thought. Okay, I will make a note of that. Thank you. So reciprocal effort. So yeah, and then in addition to that payoff of being able to follow people's work, rather than just relying on people kind of finding the heart to give you good feedback back, posting Mosaic projects was also seen as a way of giving back to others, which you had to do anyway if you wanted feedback on anything. So there was kind of like a built-in tit for tat thing here. Lastly, Mosaic users mentioned that thinking about their work in terms of process made them feel less apprehensive about sharing their work. Several people mentioned that they're apprehensive when sharing their work on existing sites due to a lack of confidence in their skills or because of negative experiences with aggressive commenters in the past. In contrast, Mosaic provided an environment where sharing process was something that everybody else was doing, making people focus less on the final outcome and more on the fact they were kind of sharing their journey with each other. So overall, Mosaic kind of demonstrates some of the benefits of designing creativity support tools and communities around outcomes other than traditional success, such as experimentation, exploration, or even failure. These are all clearly important parts of the creative process that we encounter not just in art and illustration, but in design and research and other domains. And creating these kinds of tools could help expand the ways in which we think about how we share what we make.
One question.
Oh yeah, please.
When you
start
the project, there could be many paths, like many morphing paths that you can really make in one state. Mm-hmm. Do you train somehow to rotate it through one path, or is just you can have more than one path?
Oh, so for their creative process, like how, yeah, so that was something we thought about for when we're kind of thinking about the original idea for this process, was like kind of tied with the idea of like experimentation. Like, do we want to encourage people to like try out different paths and kind of document where that took them? And so we decided to focus more on existing process for now, but that was definitely something we were interested in looking at. The other thing that kind of relates to that is like, I think Mosaic isn't quite big enough to do this right now, but in the future, like if I were to kind of continue building that community, like it would be interesting to see how different people's similar creative processes by different people kind of overlap, and to see like in aggregate kind of like how people kind of branch off at different processes. I think that would be really fascinating. I think that could actually, like if we had that data, I think it would actually help us kind of understand like how people kind of break down their process, like what are certain stopping points for them and things like that, and that might kind of in turn help us design new kinds of creativity support tools. So I think exploring like possibilities of the creative process, I think is very fascinating. So yeah, that's definitely something we thought about, but haven't gotten around to doing quite yet. are there any more questions about Mosaic before I move on to other, there'll be time at the end for questions, I think. Oh, yes.
So these participants were recruited as the perception was this was a community of peers.
that was kind of the, we didn't explicitly set out to do that, but that's kind of how their perception sort of ended up at the end of this.
So what was the degree of anonymity?
So you could choose your own username and things like that, so people can kind of decide how they wanted to appear in this community. We found that a lot of the artists kind of use their, the same username they use on any other social media site. Part of it, they were motivated by, I want to use this as a resource that I can kind of plug into, my other presences online. Anonymity wasn't, a big part of this.
So you didn't see any of the typical uses of anonymity?
Yeah, so, yeah. I think probably because of the small size, for sure. I was talking to somebody else about this as well. I think there was a little bit of self-selection as part of this as well, because the people, here I am flattering a community that nobody's on right now, and hey, are you interested in being part of this thing? And so I think the people who are really gung-ho about yeah, I want to document my creative process, they kind of self-selected to be part of this community. So the people who actually cared kind of came in, which was fine for us, because for my goal, our goal with this project was proof of concept, if we can get this to work, what happens. But yeah, that's something I think moving forward, thinking about this, how does this kind of scale up, if a community like this gets bigger and bigger and bigger, what happens when people are kind of, exposing a lot of their work on here, and how are people going to abuse this additional kind of information that people are putting up. I got some questions about people being worried about this didn't happen during the study, but people being worried about oh, what if somebody are you concerned about people stealing your work and saying oh, look at all these stuffs that I did, I was the one who made this thing. There are a lot of potential things that people were kind of wondering about. They weren't super concerned about it at the time, but they were definitely potential things that sort of came up.
So there was no explicit protection against social capital manipulation?
Yes, there wasn't anything like that in this study. Yeah, but that's definitely something to think about for sure. Okay, any other questions before? All right. Okay, so in addition to this, so creators don't necessarily need to be actively present to support each other either. So we could, for this project, I kind of explored that. We could also embed existing practices in the design of creativity support tools themselves. So I explored this in a project called Motif, where we use storytelling patterns from expert examples to better support novices in creating their own video stories. And I did this as an intern at Adobe Research a couple summers ago. So it's a little bit of an older project. We're kind of thinking about the fact that telling stories is an essential part of how human beings kind of reflect on their lives and share experiences with with others. And as a result, we kind of desire to document these stories in some way. And of course, the popularity of mobile phones and other devices have made it easier to create photos and videos and other types of digital media that can accompany the stories that we tell around our lives. However, it can be really hard to even know what kinds of content to capture. So experienced storytellers might have the skeleton of a story already in mind and may be able to anticipate the sorts of things they need to capture in order to tell a story later, but the rest of us are less likely to think about the content we'll need and how we'll pull it all together. So how can we make this process of story capture and construction easier for novices? So our goal with Motif was to see if it was possible to support a middle ground between creative flexibility and structured support, which we explored by creating a mobile application called Motif that supports video storytelling for novices based on patterns extracted from expert practice. And we mainly take inspiration from the idea of pattern languages. I mean, I'm here at a design seminar. I'm sure you guys are familiar with this idea, where pattern languages describe a set of well-known practices within some field of expertise. And here we kind of distinguish this from a template specifically. We're considering patterns as these modular things that are meant to be combined and mixed to create the base for a new thing. And so the classic example being in architecture, an airport gate and a hospital waiting room both have very similar properties in the sense that they can both be places for people to wait. And that's a pattern that can be kind of referred to and altered according to the specific needs of each situation. And this idea of patterns have extended to other areas such as design and programming to kind of address reoccurring problems with commonly used solutions. And so it might be that storytelling also has common patterns that can be extracted from existing practice and made available for use by novices who are still learning. So to develop kind of our storytelling patterns for this project, we looked at a number of videos created by experts to see if we could identify common patterns between them. And the corpus of videos we looked at included video stories from the New York Times website, Rick Steves travel videos, two home videos previously created by one of the researchers, and they carried various topics including food, travel, fashion, and world news. We then performed a grounded analysis to look for groupings of shots that served a clear storytelling purpose. And so this is an example of a particular group of shots that had the purpose of introducing a travel location, and also shows how we kind of broke down each of the shots from the sequence. And once we identified and broke down a bunch of these groupings, we consolidated groupings of shots with similar storytelling purposes, as you can see here. And this process gave us these 24 patterns here. And you'll notice that there are also three different kinds of kind of blocks here. So as part of our patterns generation process, we also considered whether the pattern was used as part of a beginning, a middle, or an end. And this grammar is relatively simple, but nevertheless starts to point to how mixing and matching patterns can allow you to express a variety of different stories, unlike maybe in template-oriented approaches. And just to clarify, these patterns are definitely not meant to be like an exhaustive list of every storytelling pattern ever, but are just kind of an example of how storytelling patterns like this might be generated. And for each of the patterns we came up with, we also identified the elements that were required to make up that pattern. So here's the example clip sequence of it earlier, which was one of the groups of patterns that inspired the set the location pattern that we had. And this pattern requires a few shots recording narration about the place, as well as a few shots that are sneak preview about the rest of the video to come. We also noted the time links of each element as they appeared in the expert examples to create a kind of typical editing timeline for combining these pieces into a video, including how they might overlap. And to see how we could use the patterns we identified in a creative process that iterated between story construction and story capture, we created a mobile video storytelling application that we called Motif. And so in Motif's story construction mode, patterns are manifested as story blocks that can be stacked through the user interface to build a story. These blocks enforce a simple grammar by requiring every story to have at least one beginning, one middle, and one end. But any number of middle blocks are allowed to be combined to create the final story. And the elements required for each pattern are transformed into prompts for the user, which are listed within each block. The user can tap on a prompt to fill in that particular part of a story block with a video clip. And additionally, these prompts also appear in Motif's capture mode. So at the top of the screen, the prompts appear to the user as a reminder for what they need to capture for their eventual story. So here, users can simply swipe through the prompts that they have queued up and fill in the pieces of each block right from the screen. And so in this way, we try to strike a balance between providing guidance and providing flexibility. Patterns that we derive from expert work act as a guide rather than just a template, and novices can alter and modify these patterns as the need arises. So we have these patterns, and we have a mobile video creator tool that uses these patterns, but we wanted to see if this approach actually improved creative outcomes for novices. So we did this by running a study comparing two versions of the Motif application, the full Motif application and a version of the app without any story blocks or prompts called the control condition. We recruited 13 participants who are novices in the area of video editing and storytelling, randomly assigned them to a study condition, and asked them to walk around and create a short video story about a popular tour spot near Seattle and Stanford. And afterwards, we conducted semi-structured interviews with participants about the creation process and how they sort of made decisions while they did this task. We also wanted to get a sense for the overall quality of the videos. So two researchers and one video expert independently rated each of the participants' videos according to a rubric of things like story structure and shot coverage, shot composition, shot length, and audio content. And in the end, we received 7 videos created using the control application and 6 videos created using Motif. The videos were created by participants tended to be fairly short, only a few minutes long. And because we did give participants a list of ideas for places to visit during their video, people tended to visit the same places, However, ideas for stories were surprisingly diverse, ranging from things like a food-focused tour of local businesses, to the story of buying flowers for my partner, to the ghosts of Pike Place. And participants, especially those from the Seattle location, actually took the study as an opportunity to purchase items or pass by spots that they personally found interesting about the area but hadn't yet had a chance to see. So in this sense, participants did kind of end up acting like realistic tourists and had to deal with creating their story while navigating around a somewhat unfamiliar area and carrying like stuff that they had bought. And so here we found that story blocks, to just kind of summarize what we found that story blocks helped participants use expert examples. So participants in both conditions stated that they had a mental image of expert videos that they had seen in the past that they were kind of trying to refer to while trying to create their own video. But in the motif condition, story blocks seemed to help participants translate these mental examples into a structure for their own video story. But at the same time, these story blocks weren't perfectly suited for every story situation. Some motif participants described using story blocks as a loose guide for the sort of feeling that like a particular shot should have. So for example, this motif participant adapted a block, it's a little hard to read, adapted a block meant for capturing a view outside their vehicle window to show off a travel location, or like to indicate that like we're traveling to a new area, for their specific situation of walking to a destination. I can just show a little clip here. I don't think there's sound, but yeah, so you kind of get the idea. So story blocks seem to change how participants thought about their story, but they viewed it as more of a resource from which they could take what they needed or ignore if they felt like they had better ideas. In contrast, participants in the control condition only really got a sense of the structure that they could have had kind of after the fact. And they describe feeling awkward and indecisive during the video capture process. So this is one of the videos by the control condition participants who basically took one long shot as they narrated their thoughts about a particular point of interest. So you kind of get the idea, it's sort of like long and rambling, they didn't really know what to talk about. Second, we found that story blocks help reduce kind of cognitive load during capture. So motif participants described that being able to put together their story using story blocks prior to and during the capture portion of the task helped them focus while capturing shots. Control participants, in contrast, had to kind of mentally juggle their story idea with judgments about what to capture. And so this participant found themselves wanting to write notes to help him remember what he was capturing because there's no other structure to kind of ground the purpose of shots. So that was kind of a quick overview of what we learned there. So we learned a little bit about how story blocks and prompts affected people's story creation process. But what about quality? Were motif videos better than the control videos? And so here we asked our expert evaluator to rank, blind to condition, all of the videos created by participants in order of overall quality, and found that, yes, motif videos did receive significantly higher ranks from the expert than videos created using the control application. So motif sought to create a better way to weave together story construction and capture for novices. Our goal here was not to provide like a one-click solution to creating really attractive video stories, but to take a deeper look at how we can design technology that keeps how creators actually work in mind. We found that this approach helped novices break down expert examples and adapt those examples in their own work. And our patterns here focused on story structure in particular, but you could also imagine putting together like an essay based on patterns that show up in the New York Times, or composing a song by mixing and matching musical strategies that are used by your favorite artist. There are examples in literally everything around us, and so if we can make these examples kind of accessible through patterns, that might unlock a lot of new creative opportunities for novices. All right. Any questions here before I move on? All right. Okay. So designing systems for creativity support helps us understand kind of just one aspect of how creators can work together online. Creativity at any scale can also occur through direct collaboration. However, the bigger a group gets, the larger potential there is to generate something awesome, but the more difficult it becomes to manage a project's overall vision and coherence. So So how do you manage collaboration in large-scale environments where individual contributors have a wide variety of levels of expertise? So I looked at this problem in Mechanical Novel, where we looked at how to get the crowd to write short fiction stories in a self-managed way. And Sarah was a co-author on this project, yay! If you've heard of crowdsourcing, I'm sure you have, you know it's shown itself to be an incredible tool for getting a large amount of work done in a short amount of time. For example, by having individual people each draw one frame for a music video, or even having crowd workers break down a problem like writing an essay into subtasks for themselves to work on. And currently, crowds use a number of proven strategies to split up this work, including offering prizes for the best submission, dividing work into small equal chunks, or structuring work as part of an assembly line or a workflow. And all of these strategies requires predetermining a particular desired outcome and prescribing to crowds exactly what to do to create that outcome. And this usually means that using these strategies, crowd workers work very independently. Any connection between workers is usually in the form of work being passed from one worker to another, and this kind of limits the kind of work that we can crowdsource. So for example, let's look at one example of a relatively complex creative work, which is story writing. So using a traditional crowdsourcing workflow, an attempt at breaking down the task of writing a story might look something like this, splitting the writing work into independent parts that you can piece together later, or by using a workflow to build on the task step by step. However, this means that these systems can't crowdsource work that has mutually interdependent parts. So for something like a story, changing the name of a character, for example, requires you to have to go through and change all mentions of this character elsewhere. And this gets even more complex if you start changing more abstract things, like a character's motivation. So to make these changes, in contrast to current crowdsourcing systems that assume a predetermined workflow, an author has to have the flexibility to revisit work that's already been done in response to later changes. So rather than breaking down work by splitting it into independent steps, maybe we should enable the crowd to follow a process that looks a little bit more like an expert's. So instead of doing creative crowdsourcing like crowdsourcing, maybe we can do creative crowdsourcing like creativity. In fact, we do know that creative experts use reflection to engage in a sort of conversation with their work. When they reflect, they continually evaluate whether they like where they're going and think about what their next step should be. So what would it look like for a crowd to collaboratively reflect on their work? To do this, the crowd could loop between two phases. First, they reflect on the work so far to brainstorm and choose a high-level goal to pursue next. Then they revise the work by decomposing that goal into small, actionable tasks that guide what edits workers should make. And to explore this technique, we created a system called Mechanical Novel for writing purely crowdsourced short fiction stories hooked into Mechanical Turk. The crowd starts by creating a first draft in response to a story prompt. And though this first draft is usually not super great, this allows the crowd to set an initial rough direction for the story's idea. So here we start off with a story prompt, the hot air balloon, where a boy named Malcolm accidentally flies to a city in the sky. And the crowd writes a short story one paragraph at a time and uses votes to pick the best text for each section. So this part is a pretty typical kind of crowdsourcing process. Next, the crowd starts to reflect. So to do this, we ask workers to critique the story using a simple feedback structure where the worker writes something that they liked, something that they wished was different, and a speculative what if that offers a possible change that the story could make next. And we use these generated what ifs as candidates for the crowd's next goal for the story. So here, workers have offered a few different changes, like what if we could learn a little bit about Malcolm, or what if we could expand the ending so that Malcolm gets to explore the cloud city. The crowd then votes to select one of these options as the main high-level goal for work. So let's say that the crowd votes to expand the story's ending so that Malcolm can explore the cloud city. The crowd then starts their revise phase. So after picking this high-level goal, the crowd votes for which sections of the story need to change in order to achieve this goal, along with specific suggestions for what that change should be, or what this change should be. So here the crowd makes a few votes indicating that most workers think that the last paragraph of the story needs to change in order to achieve the goal of expanding the ending. And some options that workers have written for expanding the ending is to have Malcolm exit the balloon and explore, or to write in a villain that Malcolm has to defeat before he can leave. Workers then vote among these suggestions, so let's say that workers decide that Malcolm should get out of the hot air balloon to take a look around.
I'm unclear about the mechanics here. How the crowd works. Is it, do the individual crowd members do things sequentially, or does the crowd kind of somehow collaborate all together in some kind of...
Yeah, so, yes, so that's a good question. So it is sequential, so there's no, like, live editing or anything going on. Only to kind of, like, technically kind of simplify how this all works together. Yeah, does that answer your question?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
One, sorry.
Yeah.
But each member of the crowd has access to complete documents.
Yeah. Yes, kind of. So everybody can read what is going on, but there's only certain parts of the story unlocked, depending on what the crowd decided needed to be edited. So, like, so earlier in the kind of, in the revised stage, okay, so, like, in the reflection stage, people are kind of saying, like, okay, like, we're brainstorming, the crowd is saying, we're going to brainstorm about a higher level goal. Okay, we voted for one that we want to change the overall story. Then in the revised stage, the next step is for the crowd to kind of vote for what parts of the story need to change. So they can see the whole story, but they can kind of, like, say, like, I think this section and this section needs to change in order to achieve this goal.
So is it dynamically
notable or a set of notes? Yes, yeah. So once those sections get voted on and, like, most of the crowd thinks that they agree that these parts need to change, then those parts get unlocked for the crowd to, like, actually make edits to, if that makes sense. Okay.
Is there someone that has ultimate control over the order, when the crowd is ready to move on? Does someone say the crowd is ready to move on, or is that how the crowd know it's ready to move on?
Yeah, so for this particular project, we just had, like, we just set an arbitrary threshold of, like, I forget exactly what number we want to, like, we just wait for, like, enough votes, and then the majority, like, thing that got voted for is, like, the thing that gets chosen as a high-level goal or the thing that gets moved on. I'm sure there's other ways of doing it, but that was, for us, kind of the simplest way of kind of testing out this whole, like, technique or workflow, and just kind of seeing how it worked. Crowd workers have chosen, like, this is the particular paragraph that should change, and they've also voted for exactly how that should change. And that that suggestion that gets the most votes becomes a microtask that asks workers to edit the text for a particular section by acting as specific instructions for how that section should change. So at this step, workers see that request to incorporate Malcolm getting out of the hot air balloon into the last paragraph. Once edits are made and workers vote for the best version of edits, this ends the revision phase of work. And so that kind of completes one round of reflection and revision. And sort of with multiple loops like this, you can see kind of how the story might change over time at sort of a high level. Okay, so in this way, the crowd is able to determine a high-level goal for themselves, which becomes a measuring stick against which all workers can see if their contributions are doing the right thing and fitting in with other people's work, all without the need for a core leader or a static workflow that coordinates everything. So with this system, our hypothesis was that allowing the crowd to revise their goals as they generate creative work will result in better creative outcomes than approaches that do not allow for reflection. And so to look at this, I ran two studies. The first was a benchmark evaluation to see whether a mechanical novel would be able to detect and fix problems we artificially introduced to a short story. And the second study was to see if a mechanical novel would be able to write a short story from scratch, and to look at the quality of the stories that get written. Both of these studies had two experimental conditions, the mechanical novel condition, which used the system I just described to write stories, and the control condition, which represented a more typical crowdsourcing workflow where workers jump straight into voting for how to edit a story and actually making those edits, and they do not choose a high-level goal. So first, the benchmark study. So with this, we wanted to get a sense of mechanical novel strengths and weaknesses and see if it was something that we actually kind of wanted to move forward with. We started out with a short story written by one of the co-authors. It was Sarah on the paper, and who she has an experience as an author. She wrote this original story, and then she chose six common types of story problems, ranging from low-level things like typo and grammar to high-level things like adding unnecessary characters. And then using the original story as a base, she wrote six new stories, each introducing one of these six problems. And so this kind of gave us a sort of a gold standard to work from, as we knew exactly where and what the major problems were for each story and how we'd expect somebody to fix them. We then ran Mechanical Novel and the control system over each story for one revision round, and then we repeated all of that 3 times. Lastly, we looked at workers' votes for which paragraphs to edit, as well as the actual edits that they made to paragraphs to determine how often crowd workers were able to detect the problem present in the story, as well as how often crowd workers were able to actually fix the problem. And so for this, just to highlight the most interesting findings, we found that Mechanical Novel was more likely to identify the correct problematic story sections for the abrupt ending problem and the extra characters problem, while the control condition was better at detecting lower level issues like typos. Both were equally good at detecting and fixing sudden changes in the narrator's point of view. And these findings carried over to each system's strengths in fixing certain problems as well, as Mechanical Novel workers seemed better at fixing the abrupt ending, and even though both systems were able to detect out-of-character dialogue, Mechanical Novel was a little better at fixing this issue. So already we can kind of see a trend towards Mechanical Novel being strong at addressing higher-level problems with story and plot, while the control system predictably seemed to be better at addressing lower-level technical issues like spelling and grammar. So seeing how Mechanical Novel might differ from traditional and crowdsourcing workflows seemed pretty promising, so we wanted to see how Mechanical Novel would perform in writing a story from scratch. So to do this, we came up with 5 story prompts ranging a variety of topics. From these, the crowd generated a first draft for each story containing about 6 scenes of text. And then we duplicated these first drafts so that the stories in the control condition and the Mechanical Novel condition started from the same base text. We then ran each story through 5 rounds of revision through each system. Once stories were written, to evaluate stories for quality, we asked 215 Mechanical Turk workers who had not worked on any of the story writing tasks to compare the control and Mechanical Turk versions for a random story in terms of specific dimensions like imagery and story structure, and we did an analysis of all story activity and feedback. So in the end, over 400 Mechanical Turk tasks and 200 unique workers later, we ended up with 10 stories, 5 revised by the control condition and 5 revised by Mechanical Novel. Stories took about 11 days to go through 5 rounds of revision on average. And again, these were short stories, so less than 1,000 words long. And overall, we did find that readers liked stories written by Mechanical Novel better. And to unpack this, we found several interesting differences between Mechanical Novel and control stories. So first, we found that Mechanical Novel stories had significantly more developed plots. Readers rated Mechanical Novel stories as having more complete story arcs with clearer beginnings, middles, and ends. Readers also rated Mechanical Novel stories as having significantly more original and interesting central story ideas, which is notable considering that both Mechanical Novel and Control stories started from the same base first draft. And so one of the stories, the Blue Elephant story, is a good example of how Mechanical Novel was able to create a better story arc, or a more complete story arc. In the original story, a young girl realizes that her prized stuffed elephant is gone, looks all over for it, and is reunited with it, and finds that it has come to life. In the control version, workers attempted to motivate the main character's search by describing her relationship with the elephant, and tried to add a reason for the elephant's disappearance. So a little bit of an improvement. The Mechanical Novel version, in contrast, starts out with a description of how Kaylee received the elephant from her grandmother, which is the same doll that her recently deceased mother had when she was a little girl. And workers also tied this idea into the ending, where she reveals that Kaylee's love for her grandmother was what brought the blue elephant to life, creating kind of a specific theme that threads through the whole story and brings it together. Second, we found that Mechanical Novels seem to focus workers' efforts towards improving the narrative. So it seems that workers in the control condition spent more of their effort on fixing grammar and spelling compared to Mechanical Novel workers. In contrast, Mechanical Novel stories were rated as having better imagery and description and writing style. And this focus on fleshing out the story itself was also corroborated by the analysis we did on the types of edits that workers actually made to each story, where we found that workers in the Mechanical Novel condition made significantly more edits that expanded on describing characters, while workers in the control condition trended towards making more edits related to fixing grammar and spelling. So for example, in the control version of the John Doe story, which is a story about a man who finds himself in heaven, started out like this, a very straightforward description of the main character's surroundings. The Mechanical Novel story, however, uses first-person voice to narrate the main character's thoughts and feelings as they try to process an unfamiliar place. So by this time, you're probably curious as to what one of these stories actually looked like. So I'll walk through the control and mechanical novel version of one of the stories that workers wrote during this study. This particular story was a like film noir type story titled Number 16 and was about a serial killer whose target suddenly disappears. So the initial first draft of the story, as you might expect, was filled with inconsistencies. For example, the first paragraph starts out with a major plot twist where the 2B victim actually catches the main character following her and then points a gun at him. The next paragraph continues as if that hadn't happened, describing the serial killer as waiting patiently to make his next move. And later on in the story, the point of view changes from the serial killer to the victim, suddenly drawing from that plot twist idea earlier, and starts narrating the victim's thoughts as she tries to hunt down the serial killer instead. But then the story ends with the serial killer maybe killing the victim. It's sort of unclear. It's like weirdly poetic and like not clear exactly what happened. And that's just kind of how it ends. Yeah, so in the control revision of the story, workers were able to remove this early plot twist and change the ending so that the victim does clearly turns the table on the serial killer. But by fixing these issues, the control system ended up removing much of the story arc and resulting in a kind of monotone plot and an ending that seems pretty random. In contrast, the mechanical novel version of the story, like the control condition, also changes the ending so that the tables are clearly turned on the killer, but also and it also removes the early plot twist from the beginning. But rather than removing the plot twist altogether, it was transformed instead into foreshadowing for later parts of the plot. In addition, mechanical novel workers also added backstories for the serial killer and the victim to explain kind of why they're doing what they're doing in the story. Just another example of how mechanical novels seem to focus a little bit more on expanding characters. So in summary, through mechanical novel, we saw what happened when we enabled crowds to collaborate on complex creative work through a technique where the crowd reflects on their work and translates those reflections into concrete revisions. In a crowd story writing experiment, workers in the mechanical novel condition focused on higher level story problems than workers in the control condition and were able to select reasonable high level goals for themselves and use these goals to break down the task of revising a short story into coordinated actions. And so hopefully this shows that this technique on reflecting and revising can be an effective complement to existing crowdsourcing techniques to allow the workers themselves to influence the direction of work and shows the possibility of cooperating with crowds and other types of complex work as well. Okay, so in this talk I asked three research questions to explore how creators can better support creators and how to build systems to let people collaborate on complex creative work. We found that to help creators support each other as they work, we can create communities that act more like design studios rather than galleries. We can scaffold novice work by creating patterns based on examples from experts, and that letting reflection drive collaborative action can allow crowds to work together flexibly. And so moving forward in my current and future work, I'm thinking a lot about the fact that I think creativity researchers, both at Adobe and elsewhere, have come up with all these like magical tools to help people create good-looking stuff at like the touch of a button. But when you have the power to, when we have the technology and the power to kind of create whatever we want, how do you kind of decide what you even want to make? And so I'd like to continue working on developing design principles and systems oriented around helping users engage with each other in terms of how they work and deciding what they're going to do. And I think it'll be really important in making sure that people. This will be really important in making sure that people are able to make the most of all this cool technology and design work that we're doing. Okay, that's pretty much it. Thanks so much for listening. I hope that was interesting. And I should also mention, if anybody is interested in collaborating on projects related to these research areas, totally let me know. I'm a fledgling industry researcher, and I would love to continue collaborating with other people on this stuff. And other than that, I'd be happy to take any questions now. Thanks.
General, it seems like it.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's why it's so hard, right? Like, people really struggle with it, and I think that's why sometimes we tend to be like, let's forget about the user and just like go like technology first a little bit, because like if we can cool this, like create this cool thing, then like people will just like figure it out, you know? So like, I feel like that's a big assumption nowadays, is like, and I don't think it's necessarily true that like if we can give people lots of examples, they'll be able to like pick from them or like whatever. Like, I don't know if it's true that we have a good sense of judgment for that kind of thing. And I think there definitely has to be a balance of like on one hand, we can kind of like guide people to like, hey, here's how to create a good story, but then it's also like, you also want to expose them to lots of different ways of doing things, because they may not know that this exists and whatever. And so like, there has to be a balance between like serendipity and then, but also like structure. And I think part of it, the key to that is going to be figuring out like understanding people, like being able to figure out people's intent at certain points in time, and then also figuring out like what creative strategies are the right thing to do at which time, and trying to balance that. So it's definitely hard, like but that's also why it's really interesting. So
I got time for one more question.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah.
You know, it's highly imaginative. I see them building all kinds of stuff, transportation, art, guns, whatever.
Yeah.
but they seem to be extremely cooperative. Each one goes into the other one's world and see what the other one has, things like that.
Mm.
And it's so engaging, and they can keep on making new things all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So is there something that we can learn from those creators or the Minecraft that we can use?
I totally think so. Like, I think that would be a great research project to see how, like, people, what they do in these kind of open world, like, sandbox type games, right? Like, how do people figure out, like, because I know that was something that I struggled with. I tried to play Minecraft because I heard it was popular, and I was like, oh, I'm going to get into this really popular game. And then I was like, I don't know what to do. Like, how do I even do these things? And so it'd be really, I think, very fascinating to kind of figure out, like, how do people kind of get over that barrier? Because I think figuring out what strategies people use there can apply to lots of other things. And then also, how do people kind of keep going? What motivates to kind of keep creating these things? Like, where do these ideas come from? Do they just do it themselves? Like, I think there's a lot of strategies there that we could learn from. So, Minecraft, that's definitely something to look at. It may be a good excuse to play Minecraft. Yeah. Thank you.
On that note, Minecraft, everybody. All right. Thank you, Troy.